Good morning, everyone. In this session of collaborative learning, we will be covering a long answer question in the topic of mandibular fracture. So my long answer question for today is, define fracture. How will you diagnose and treat mandibular angle fracture in adult? So to make this simpler for you, I have prepared a skeleton onto which we will build up the answer. So for this question, I mean this particular question, there is specific marks assigned for each aspect of the question. So we will be preparing points onto which we can build up the answer later. So these are a few points that we have to include in the answer. First is definition, then is diagram. Then in diagnosis, we tend to forget to mention the case history, which is very important in any case related to trauma. So never forget to mention the case history, the clinical examination and radiographic examination. Then we go for the treatment. In treatment, we will first mention the principles of treatment pertaining to any kind of fracture. So that is mentioned. Then treatment objectives and then the basic line of treatment. Then to begin with the definition, fracture is defined as break in the continuity, break in the structural and natural continuity and integrity of the bone. Then mandibular fracture is the fracture involved in the mandible. So as we've known now that we have to introduce the topic a bit. So to introduce the fracture of the angle of the mandible, just mention how the fracture line goes. So the fracture of the angle of the mandible involves the junction of the posterior end of the alveolar process and the body of the mandible with the ramus, from where the fracture line extends downwards. Caused, this fracture line is caused due to the impact over the same side of the mandible between the canine and the second molar region, or violence on the chin on the opposite side. Then we go to the clinical history. So in clinical history, we need to mention, we need to ask a few points which are very important. So we first ask the patient for any bone disease, any neoplasia, any if the patient has arthritis, which further leads to the risk of ankylosis. Then vascular diseases, metabolic disorders, seizures, and events related to the trauma. So I've prepared a small mnemonic to remember all the questions that are supposed to be asked to when we are taking a clinical history. So you know, you don't need to mention this in your answer, but it is just good to know. So the mnemonic goes like AMPLE, A-M-P-L-E. So A stands for allergy, M stands for medication, P is for past illness, L is for the last meal that the patient has had, and E stands for events related to the injury. Then we go for the clinical examination. So whenever we mention or write about the clinical examination, let's make it systematic and not haphazard. So make two columns specifying inspection and palpation differently. So for angle of the mandible, these are the few clinical examination clinical features that we see in the patient. So first is swelling, ecchymosis, erythema, abrasion, laceration or contusion, step deformation, occlusion, derangement, ipsilateral open bite in unilateral angle fracture, and anterior open bite in bilateral angle fracture. So these are the these last two points have to be mentioned in the answer, as this is very specific pertaining to angle of the fracture of the angle of the mandible. Then in palpation, we check the tenderness, crepitus, trismus, and paresthesia of the lip. Then we go to the radiographic examination. Here we just need to chalk down the various methods that are used. First is the periapical view. Then we have the OPG, the panoramic radiograph, the lateral oblique, the PA mandible, reverse Downs view, CT scan and MRI. So now that we are going to answer only specific to angle of the mandible, OPG, panoramic radiograph, lateral oblique and PA mandible have to be mentioned at any cost. So because these record the angle of the mandible perfectly. Then we go to the principles of treatment. So in principles of treatment, we have to go in a stepwise and in a chronological order. So first we mentioned the conservative treatment. If conservative treatment doesn't work, we go to definitive treatment. If definitive treatment doesn't work, we go to surgical. So equal amount of importance has to be given to all three lines of treatment rather than only surgical treatment. Then treatment objectives. So treatment objectives is basic rationale or the reason why or the expectations we have to have with the kind of treatment that we'll be giving to the patient. So these 5 points have to be known to everyone. So these carry a lot of marks. So first is restoration of the mandible form and projection. Second is restore occlusion based on where facets present the pre-existed occlusion in predetermined and restored. Stable fixation for early use of jaw to withstand masticatory forces. Then restoring the normal TMJA movements and function. Then in case of displaced fracture, compressing inferior alveolar nerve, fracture reduction and fixation should relieve nerve compression, which means in case if the fracture is compressing any vital structure around the mandible, the fracture should be adequately reduced and fixated to relieve the nerve compression. So it's basically the gist of these objectives is to restore and revitalize the function of the mandible. Then we go to the first line of treatment. We tend to miss this point very often, but any trauma or fracture of the mandible, we have to manage the patient first rather than mentioning the surgical very well. So do not forget to add these points. So the way we manage or the first line of treatment for this kind of patient has to be management of airway first, where you manage the tongue falling back, you check for blood clots, fractured teeth segments, broken fillings, dentures. Then for hemorrhage, soft tissue laceration, support of the bone fragments, pain control, infection control, example compound fractures, and food and fluid. So as soon as a patient of facial injuries is brought to the hospital, he or she should be examined for airway, breathing, circulation, neurological deficit or disability, and exposure and examination of the whole body. So even if you remember the ABCDE of first line of treatment, you are good to go. Then we go for the main treatment line. First is reduction, then fixation and immobilization. These are the 3 points you have to include in any treatment for fracture. So first is reduction. Reduction is just restoration of functional alignment of the bone fragments. So we either do open reduction or closed reduction. Then we do something called as fixation. So fixation is just joining the reduced fragments of the bone. Then there is immobilization, which is done to allow the bone healing, and which is done along the through the fixation of fracture line. So immobilization is either rigid or non-rigid. So what is reduction? So reduction of functional alignment of bone fragments. So instead of going in too much detail of this, even if we cover the important points, it is sufficient. So in closed reduction, it depends on the splinting of the mandible to the maxilla to restore centric occlusion. This includes IMF, which is intermaxillary fixation. Then we use IV loop, continuous multiple loop wiring, indirect dental wiring, distal wiring, circummandibular wiring, and occlusal dental children. So intermaxillary fixation or IMF is actually immobilization of the maxilla and mandible in maximum intercuspation position with the aid of wiring in a closed position. So we do not open the wound. We try to immobilize the fracture line and reduce the surgical procedure. So, and in open reduction, it is continued displacement of the bony segments and mostly done in unfavorable fractures. For example, angle fracture. So, in angle fracture, we need to go for an open reduction, basically. Then, for open reduction, we have intraosseous wiring with intermaxillary fixation for 3 to 8 weeks. Then, rigid internal fixation or plating. So in this method, we use bone plates, bone screws, or both to fix the fracture. And we have lag screws, intermedullary pinning, and external pin fixation. So in case of open reduction, which generally needs to be done in angular fractures, there is an intraoral approach to the angle of the mandible and the ramus. So in the previous discussion, we've already seen various approaches to the angle of the mandible. So here I'm just trying to summarize this. Even if you draw this diagram, it is sufficient in the exam. So we first tend to go for the vestibular incision or the Ward's modified incision. We've seen both these incisions before. So these are the ways of opening the or approaching the angle of the mandible intraorally. Then we have immobilization. In immobilization, we have intermaxillary fixation with osteosynthesis. Then we have intermaxillary fixation and then osteosynthesis without intermaxillary fixation. So there are various methods that we use for each. For example, osteosynthesis without intermaxillary fixation, we use non-compression small plates, compression plates, mini plates, and lag screws. So this is just a general line of treatment we use for immobilization angle of fractures, which is done for around 3 weeks. Then there is intermaxillary fixation done using bonded brackets, dental wiring, which is direct or eyelet wiring, arch bars, caplins, and IMF screws. Then for osteosynthesis without intermaxillary fixation, osteosynthesis without intermaxillary fixation, we use non-compression small plates, compression plates, mini plates, and lag screws. And for intermaxillary fixation with osteosynthesis, we use transosseous wiring. So we are going to, for this, we are going to they have the osteosynthesis or bone joining. So for that, we need to use transosseous wiring, external pin fixation, and circumferential wiring. So this is the particular line of treatment for the angle of the fracture. So instead of writing everything that we know about the management of fracture, this is the gist of the management of angle of fracture. So even if we write, so these points need to be included. So first line of treatment or first line of surgical line of treatment goes with closed reduction and fixation of the dentulous mandible done by placement of IV loop using 24 gauge wire between two stable teeth with use of a smaller gauge wire to provide maxillomandibular fixation, that is MML, between the IV loop. So between the two stable teeth, we do closed reduction and fixation for 3 to 6 weeks. Then multiple approaches for open reduction and internal fixation, which is ORIF, O-R-I-F, open reduction and internal fixation. So there are various approaches for this. So consider the fracture location, the nerve position, and skin crease lines when choosing the appropriate approach. So for ORIF, there are various approaches that we use: the posterior vestibular approach, the submandibular approach, and retromandibular approach. These are the same approaches that we use for the treatment of the angle of the fracture. So we did not go into the depth of this, but I've just mentioned the advantages and disadvantages of all these approaches. So for the posterior vestibular approach, there's a diagram here as we can see. And then advantages and cases of increased aesthetic demand and avoidance of extraoral scar. As you know, this is going to be intraoral, so scarring will be minimal. Then disadvantages would be skeletonization is necessary. Then submandibular approach. Then in submandibular approach, the advantages, it allows optimal manipulation of the fragments. And in disadvantages, care should be taken for marginal mandibular nerve, facial artery, and vein. Then retromandibular approach, the advantages have to be posterior angle fractures. Disadvantages should be care should be taken for retromandibular vein and facial nerve. Then we go for the single mini plate. The indications for the single mini plate fixation are isolated single fracture of the angle, as you can see in the diagram below. Then two mini plate, the indication is bilateral angle fracture. and the second is associated maxillary fracture. So for the angle of the mandible, the immobilization for a young adult is going to be 3 weeks. But as you closely look into the question that we've been asked, we've been asked to manage an adult. So for a young adult, it is going to be 3 weeks. And for the age of a person more than 40 years, it is going to be 5 to 6 weeks. So with this, I end my presentation. Thank you and take care.